everyone. Today in Literature with Prabhat, we are going to discuss Dalit aesthetic. Before discussing Dalit aesthetic, let us discuss the history of caste in India. It is generally believed that Manu in Manusmriti propagated the Chatur Varna. However, the mention of caste is there in Vedic period as well and in texts like Bhagavad Gita. It is mentioned in Rig Veda, which was published between 1200 to 900 BCE in the Purush Sukta hymns. The whole idea of caste was first challenged by Buddhists by creating Sanghas, which admitted everyone regardless of their castes. Ambedkar believed that the caste system took shape because of the conflict between the settled and nomadic tribes. First, a section of nomadic tribe started agricultural activities and got settled. The unsettled and broken tribes adopted Buddhism, and the settled one started having a contempt towards them, so they became untouchables. For Huon Roy, it happened much before Buddhism, and it is a conflict between the food gatherers and food producing people. In 19th and 20th century, social reformers attacked the hereditary and the basis of distinction and the law of karma, which defended casteism. There were reformers like Ghasi Das, who founded Satnami sect. Now we'll discuss about debate between Gandhi and Ambedkar, because it is necessary to understand the whole Dalit movement. For Gandhi, inequality should be removed from caste system. And he didn't reject the caste system itself. He just said that inequality should not be there in caste system. There is a quote from him where he says that, "I believe that if Hindu society has been able to stand, it is because it is founded on caste system." So he thinks that the whole caste structure, the whole Chatur Varna structure, is necessary for the Hindu society to be stable. But he rejected the inequality between the different castes. For him, they were Harijans or children of God, which was considered patronizing by the Dalit community, because they didn't like the whole attitude of patronization by the term used, which was Harijan. On the other hand, there was Baba Saheb Ambedkar, who rejected caste system altogether. In his book Annihilation of Caste, he proposes that the caste system reaffirms the Brahmin's hegemony, because each caste oppressed inferior castes and was in turn subjected to the Brahmin's contempt. The Dalit movement stands on this ground of the difference between the views of Ambedkar and Gandhi. It depends on the total rejection of the Gandhian view when it comes to the existence of caste. In British period, there was no change, however, of the disintegration of the caste system, as there was no equality, not even a bourgeois equality. Therefore, all those who believed, as well as those who didn't believe in the caste system, came together to fight against it. However, the Britishers used all their strategic might to please both kinds of people. They changed their views on caste according to what the different segments thought about it. So, for example, they supported the Chatur Varna system when it came to the caste Hindus. And they also introduced modern education for the Dalits. So by that, doing that, they also pleased the Dalits themselves. After India got independence, the constitution which was drafted by Ambedkar tried to remove the social stigmas related to the caste system, especially untouchability. According to the Article 17 of the constitution, untouchability is abolished and its practice in any form is forbidden. The enforcement of any disability arising out of untouchability shall be an offense punishable in accordance to the law. In order to bring equality for the Dalits, several movements happened after independence as well. One of them was Dalit Panthers movement, which was inspired from the American Black Panthers movement against the racial profiling of the African Americans. They were quite active and effective in their mission as the movement spread into the society, including the urban neighborhoods, institutions, and the government offices. At the first conference of Maharashtra Dalit Sahitya Sangh in 1958, the term Dalit literature came into use. In order to bring about a change in their social condition, they needed social, cultural, religious, and creative equality. Thus, they rejected literary conventions and language rigidities of the classical literature of upper caste and decided to create a literature of their own that may help them carve a new identity for themselves. Babu Rao Bagul, a Dalit activist and writer, says that Dalit literature takes man as its center. It participates in man's joy and sorrows and leads him to a just revolution. It teaches equality to the mass of humanity, that is, society. There was no discussion about aesthetics in Dalit literature until 1988. When Sarat Patil wrote Abrahmani Sahityanche Saundarya Shastra. In this work, he argued that since Dalit literature has no aesthetics of its own, it is relying on the Brahmanical aesthetics. He asserted that aesthetics is like a weapon and every revolutionary literature has acquired it. Now we'll discuss about Sharan Kumar Limbale's Towards an Aesthetics of Dalit Literature, History, Controversies and Consideration. It was published in the English version of the work was translated and edited by Alok Mukherjee in 2004. So, who is a Dalit? While discussing that, Limbale says that Harijans and Neo-Buddhists are not the only Dalits. The term describes all the untouched communities living outside the boundary of the village, as well as Adivasis, landless farm laborers, workers, the suffering masses, and nomadic and criminal tribes. In explaining the word, it will not do to refer only to the untouchable castes. People who are lagging behind economically will also need to be included. Dalit aesthetics rejected rasa and dhvani theory of Indian aesthetics. Dalit literature deconstructs and questions the very foundation of Indian mythology and constructs a new story. To take an example, Dalit writers focus on legendary figures of Eklavya and Sambhuka rather than the Pandavas and the language used in their native speech. Dalit literature is an outcome of their experiences rather than being a mere observation of Dalit lives. A literature that supports inequality is not only unacceptable for them. In their views, there must be a mass movement against such literature. Dalit literature contradicts tradition and thus obstructs the process of enjoyment by casting a shadow on the conscious and unconscious prejudices and assumptions held by the reader. Sharan Kumar Limbale discussed Marathi Savan literature in particular. And he says that if pleasure is the basis of the aesthetics of Marathi Savan literature, pain and suffering is the basis of the aesthetics of Dalit literature. It is a literature that is intended to make readers restless or angry and not to please their senses. According to the Savarna aesthetic theory, the beauty of an artistic creation lies in the expression of world consciousness or other wilderness. This traditional theory is universalistic and spiritualistic. But Dalit literature rejects spiritualism and abstraction. Its aesthetic is material rather than spiritualist. It believes in the artistic rendering of the reality. Dalit writers give priority to problems of society over the entertainment of the readers. They express their feelings in their literature. They do not create literature with urban readers in mind. Their effort is to transport the aesthete readers to their own level of experience. Thus, a great or good work will be the one which arouses a Dalit consciousness in readers. The readers must think about things like freedom, love, justice, and equality after reading Dalit literature. So, for example, there are works like Children of God by Santa Kumar Rao, which discusses the problems in a life of Dalit. And there are other autobiographies, for example, Jhoothan by Om Prakash Valmiki, which we'll be discussing later, that discusses the pain and sufferings of Dalit life. And it is much more materialistic or individualistic than being universal or spiritual, like the works which uses the Indian aesthetics. So today we discussed Dalit aesthetics, and in the next class we'll be discussing Jhoothan by Om Prakash Valmiki, so that you can have a better understanding of Dalit aesthetics. So please like, subscribe and share this video as much as you can, and thank you for listening to this lecture.